A first question when getting into beer is, does the type of beer matter? It's all the same ingredients. Nobody's making this big a deal over tuna and sweet corn sandwiches, for example. There are bigger issues, like world hunger and the bins. Besides, it's all just boogie juice in the end. Well, yes, it does matter. Knowing about beer makes every drink better, and it was already pretty good. Modern innovation of beer brewing has spawned the craft brewing industry, where upstarts try their hand at brewing unique beverages. And while the big brands will never be toppled, the craft beer industry is enjoying strong growth, fueled by peaking interest by the public. These craft beers cost so much, it makes you want to get into craft brewing. A single can of craft beer might cost as much as a six-pack from the big brand stuff. It forces you to savor it, Stockholming you into liking the beer. With this increase in price, you'd hope for a higher quality. If it's quality you want, then the big brands are best. They have perfected a product that is purposefully less tasteful and consistent. But what's consistency compared to the blood, sweat, and tears within every can of craft beer, which you can barely taste? So what's in beer? Obviously, it depends on the beer. A Belgian triple may contain just hops, water, yeast, and malt, whereas a Californian pale ale may have as many ingredients as yeast, hops, malt, and water. Yeah, all beers are just made with four ingredients. I won't get too technical into the process because I can't. Malt is a cereal grain, hops are flours, yeast is a fungus, and water is a liquid used to reduce hangovers. And of course, in every beer, there is a bit of love, which leaves a slightly salty aftertaste and does not wash out well. Malts are grains that have been malted. They provide the sugars that will be converted into alcohol. By roasting the malt, you can create dark beers such as ports and stouts, depending on who's hosting the roast and where it's being aired. Barley is traditionally used, but corn and rice can be cheap alternatives with less street cred. Hops give bitterness to a beer, like the sun to British people, the rain to British people to French people, and British people to British people. Hoppy has become a descriptive factor in beer, but every beer has hops. It's become a challenge to see how many times a craft beer can tell you it's hoppy on the packaging, but that's like calling a human facey. The hoppy taste in beer is the aroma and fruity elements of the particular hops. A beer is about 85% water, 10% passion, 15% pain, and 100% reason to remember that the type of water matters, because it's most of the beer. Yeast is the least cared about ingredient. It converts the sugars into alcohol and adds the bubbles, nature's soda stream. But despite doing all the active work in the process, everybody treats yeast like a joke. It's the Ringo of the Beatles. Each style differs, from beers designed to lack flavor to beers having so much flavor it burns. Every style provides a base set of characteristics that can be then tinkered with by the brewer. Like an RPG class in a game, you've got the guy who's good with guns, boring, but you understand him and he gets the job done. The brute character that is in your face and hits hard. The rogue character who is subtle and requires skills to master, and the mage who does whatever the fuck bull they can think of. There are two main groups for beers, lagers and ales. Lagers have less head, are smoother, and is the beer you choose to get drunk on. An ale is smelly, a bit stronger, and the beer you accidentally get drunk on. These beers are fermented with different yeast strains, which is only made more interesting when looking at the full names. Ales can have a fruity aroma, which is celebrated, despite there being no fruits within a 3-mile radius of a pub. These macho men will joke about women and their smelly candles, and then have an in-depth discussion about the notes of elderflower in their beer. Smell is 60 to 110% of a beer's taste, according to several unreliable sources, even though the casual drinker may be more familiar with the morning after smell of beer, which is not as celebrated. The beer style that everybody is familiar with is the American lager. It's the most drinkable and drunk beer, what the drunks mostly drink. It's the most popular style of beer in the world, which isn't surprising, knowing how many decades of research went into removing any taste and lowering the alcohol levels. You couldn't escape it if you tried. The advertisement executives wouldn't let you. As it's the main product of these multi-billion dollar corporations, like Walter White's Blue Meth, except it's not a good quality product, and it's responsible for more death and poverty. The most in vogue style of beer is definitely the IPA. If you've talked to a man in a flannel shirt in the last 10 years, you will have heard of it. Almost every small brewery needs to make an IPA because they sell so well, and every third pub quiz asks the question, what does IPA stand for? It's exploded in popularity after the US started experimenting with it in the 70s. The extra hops were originally added so that the beer lasted in longer journeys, but now it's a feature. The remodeled IPA is now called the American Indian Pale Ale. But the beers themselves prefer to be called Native American Pale Ales. To describe it in one sentence is hard, because the flavors range from melons to milkshakes, but But in general, it's a bitter, hoppy style. It's not always bitter, and hoppy isn't really a descriptor. It does, however, always have a high alcohol content, except when it doesn't. The styles and preferences of beers depend on the region it hails from. There are four main regions of beer origins as we know it in the Western world. Belgium is a country rich in culinary history, from Belgian waffles to Belgian chocolate and Belgian beer. The country puts as much effort into naming as they put into smoothing their roads. I don't know if you've ever been on a Belgian roller coaster, but it's a nice break from the ups and downs of the roads. The home of lager is Germany / Eastern Europe. I'd be more specific, but over the centuries, where Germany begins and ends has been a point of heated debate. It's the beer of carnivals and Oktoberfest, a smooth, drinkable experience served in 3-liter glasses that have seen the inside and outside of Lederhosen more than any other beer. Britain is another country of beer origin. Or should I say the British Isles? As the most famous beer from this collective is Guinness, a beer that transcends borders, albeit with a lower quality. The pub is a classic British building. While many countries have tried to replicate it, you can't quite match the air of self-loathing found in a proper pub. Here, you need a spirit level to prevent spillage, you don't need to cool the beers because the country does that for you, and pubs serve 4 beers on draft. Guinness, 2 others, and Stella Artois if you like to beat your wife. And then there are the American styles, taking bits from all over the world and fucking with them in different ways. The American people may be loud and in your face, but their beers are also that. What can you test to call a beer good or shit? Appearance, aroma, taste, aftertaste, mouthfeel, and perceived bitterness. Aroma is fun because it involves different smelling techniques. The proper sniffing technique is essential. One must swirl the beer to release aromas, then glass to nose for a sniff. You also have to identify the smells, but that's less important than looking like you can. You gotta treat that glass like the anus of a really interesting dog. Taste and aftertaste are difficult because I never give enough space between sips for taste to become aftertaste. Keep in mind, not all flavors are created equal. All flavors are unintended, unwanted, and show poor brewmanship. These flavors range from banana taste to a skunky aroma. Higher levels of alcohol can mask these imperfections, but generally proper sanitation will eliminate them. Mouthfeel stands out as dangerously close to wine tasting. As pretentious as it sounds, at least it's not wine tasting. The notes in beer don't require years of training in the Himalayas to pick out. Each beer style is as different as white wine is to red. Wine tasters are stereotyped as pretentious, while beer tasters are stereotyped as homeless. But at the very highest level, they're both losers galaxy braining over grape juice and bread juice. The mode of getting drink to mouth spans from tulip glass to shoe. Both are valid, but one will impart more character than the other. If the brand of beer matches the glass, then your passability is doubled. The shaker pint glass is the most common glass. It should be used for a beer during a sports game or a pub crawl. Not much head, and not much quality to be lost. Other beers are more head than beer. You'll get a lot of head from German or Belgian beers. From the UK, you can't expect anything that exciting. And in the US, it really depends on how the beer's feeling that day. If you've just picked up a beer from Untappd as a one-night thing, don't be expecting anything. Just boot up Netflix and see where the night takes you. What I'm trying to say is the glass should be suitable for the beer you're drinking. If creating your own opinions is too hard, Untappd is an app for beer rating and reviewing. It's great if you need an opinion on your beer. You can use this app to understand more about the beer, using words like hoppy and hazy to describe every other beer. The problem is the power of suggestion. Every note about a beer I see becomes my opinion. I might be tasting lemon, but as soon as the app says apple, I'm tasting apple. Untappd is a powerful tool, but also a curse. Use it wisely. You can tell a brewer by sight, or by asking them, which sounds less judgmental. While they are a great diverse range of people, the modal average is undeniable. Man, beard, flannel. Trying to get into a conversation with a brewer about their beers is like trying to find out if someone's vegan. A mother would have less to talk about their child, because a batch of beers is as close as a man can get to having children. Many newer craft beers suffer the same flaws. In order to stand out, they need to be gimmicky, with crazy names and art. There's already a lot of good beer. What they need to do is add pube flavor to get it off the shelves, and being smaller, they are more prone to brewing errors. So if in doubt, look the beer up on Untappd before purchase. From the perspective of small brewers, big beer is the bad guy. They flood market with cheap beer and give it a bad image. But people like shit beer. Why do you think McDonald's is popular? Because of the good food? And if you do some research, you'll find out that most of the small breweries are owned by big beer anyway. And the craft beer industry also does a lot to promote drinking. That's the business, to sell drinks. While it's not the 5 euro cans of milkshake IPA that people are getting drunk on, it's not helping to defeat alcohol addiction. And the difference between an alcoholic and somebody drinking 4 cans of craft beer a day is a sense of entitlement. If BoJack Horseman has taught me anything, it's that big horse funny. The elusive big bands I'm talking about are Heineken and AB InBev, the biggest beer companies in the world. They own almost all the beers you can name. You may walk into a bar and struggle to choose between Budweiser, Corona, Beck's, Jupiler, a Keefsie IPA, or a Leffe. It's the illusion of choice, as they're all owned by AB InBev, and any profits from those beers won't go to local business or industry. Just keep in mind the next time you're partaking in an alcoholic beverage or having a piss up. Is beer important? No. But is beer fun? Hell yeah. And if you research and get to know lots of beers, it's even more fun.